either David or Brian for my team. Oh, okay.
Yeah, so
All right.
I'll record it and then I'll share the thing with you. All
All
right.
right. Thank you so
So
much, Andrew.
so just to recap for the people who joined us on the recording we just started, this is OreSat engineering unit. Everything's a card, everything's a card cage, and that was done specifically to support student engineering teams and to really give a physical API application programming interface, right? Like all the damn computer science people are always like 30 years ahead of us, right, as physical people. And so this is the bus. This is the back. This is what we call the back plane. Ignore the mod wires. This is an old one. That's upside down. There you go. You can see the RF connectors, the main connectors, and then auxiliary connectors, which we didn't use for the small 1U, but we did use them in the 2U. Okay, let's go back. All right, so here we are. CAD unit, non-shape, actual 1U. It's scalable, right? So you can do a back plane in a 1, a 2, or a 3U and use the same damn cards, right? We didn't want anything bespoke as much as possible. It turns out that it's cheap enough these days, changeable, but the back plane ends up being bespoke based on where you want to put cards and solar panels and all that kind of stuff. So we've got solar modules around the outside of the X, Y plates, but not the Z plates. Same thing with the 2U, same thing with the 3U. And this was maybe a stupid decision to do this idea where we have a single solar module, and that solar module is then kind of used on each of the different, you know, it's like kind of a 1U face solar module. But we made a lot of decisions based on trying to make everything as modular as possible so we didn't have to keep redesigning everything. So, for example, this is that 1U solar module, and it's got some stuff on back. I'll go over it in a second, but this fits on each one of the outside faces of those different U's, right? So scalable quotes. So here's the internal guts. Let's talk about nomenclature because you're going to need to know it. So we have frames, and the frames are flat plates, which we'll go over in a second. Ah, shit. Sorry. Which we'll go over in a second. And these flat plates are just CNC machined out of aluminum. And then we've got the back plane, which we talked about. We've got the cards. The top and bottom cards are special. They're called end cards, and they are slightly special. Their connectors moved over, and they interface with solar panels. The end cap is special because they go up and down on top of the unit, and they're not cards. They cap off the satellite, if you will. The plus X frame is also special because that's what you take off to look on the inside and take cards out. So in sort of development mode, the plus X frame is off, and the Y and the minus X are kind of your card cage holder. Okay, so here's the frames. This is the 1U, and what's important here is that each of these frames is CNC'd from a single, like, you know, 30 millimeter, 25 millimeter sheet of aluminum and then anodized type 2 black, right? And it should be possible to machine these in your machine shop in your school. We never did because our machine shop sucks. So we went to Hubs and had Hubs make these, and they did a great job. And when you make, you know, 5 or 10 of these things, they drop in price. So these things are like a couple $100 each if you make 5 of them or something. If you make onesie twosies, then it comes up to like $1,000 per U kind of thing. So that's good. So again, here's the plus X face. This is what comes off. Here's the minus X face. You can see the fastener bosses for the back plane. And then one of the really important things that we did, and what I think really helped with the interdisciplinary engineering, is we made sure that even the mechanical engineers had a voice. Now, I know usually you don't let mechanical engineers talk. Sorry, I'm racist against mechanical engineers because, well, actually, some of my best friends are mechanical engineers, so I shouldn't say that. Anyway.
Oh, yes, a classic.
So some of the mechanical engineers said, hey, we need to be able to deal with thermal control. And so they came up, oh, sorry, and here's a kit. So we kind of make lean manufacturing kits. So this is a 1U kit. You've got some, you know, screwdrivers and some McMaster car fasteners. Everything's a McMaster car fastener. And then some custom made stuff here. And what's important about this is that the mechanical people said, hey, we want to be able to dump the heat from the cards into the frame so we can radiate it, because otherwise, you know, we'll be desoldering chips and other stuff, especially power amplifiers and whatnot. And so what they came up with is this funny system over here. We have what are called wedges and triangles, although we actually have a better system now. We've gotten rid of the triangles and we just have a single wedge piece. And what you'll see is there's three fasteners. Now there's only two. So think of two fasteners on the outside here. And when you engage the fasteners into this wedge and you pull the wedge this way, it pushes up the triangle and it clamps the cards into the card cage. And this is two purposes. One, it just absolutely turns us into a tank. Like, we've gone up to 15 Gs and had no problems whatsoever. In fact, in about a month, we'll have some hilarious discussions about spin launch, who used one of our engineering units to spin up, which makes us both cringe and laugh all at the same time. Anyway, so very, very, very mechanically sound, because these cards are clamped on the plus Y, minus Y, and plus X face. So if I show you, here is one of the Y sides. I think you can see that there's a little ramp, right? And then let me grab one of the things. This is one of the wedges. And if you look at straight on, you can see it's got a little wedge on the bottom and it's got two holes in it. And this literally fits, let me check it's right, it's hard to see, just like that. And then when you come in with two screws on the outside, it pulls it up and clamps the card. So we can take a card and we can put the ground plane of the card on the very edges and pop them out. So we remove the solder mask, right? So on the top and the bottom of the card, we take the ground plane, and that's where we clamp the force, clamp the cards into the cage. And this is super clever, because if the electrical engineers will yell and scream about not having ground loops, right? So we don't want these to be electrically connected, and they're mostly not, because the type 2 anodization makes aluminum oxide, you know, surface that's non-conductive. It's a thermally conductive because it's so thin, but it's not electrically conductive. So even though this is the ground plane, it's not electrically conducted, or not electrically conductive there. We only have one ground through the main connector. Now, that's a lie for things with a RF connector, but we're going to ignore that for now. Okay, so there's that. And then for cards where we want to separate the thermal connection, we can then take and remove the ground plane and just put the FR4 fiberglass there. And so for the battery pack that we need to heat and keep warmer than the minus 10 degrees C simulated temperature of the frame, we can just use the fiberglass and have low thermal conductivity to the frame. Okay, so we did some thermal modeling and thermal desktop. We hate thermal desktop as much as you do, but it seems to be like kind of good. And the nice part is we with OreSat Zero, that's in orbit in a sun synchronous dusk to dawn orbit, we actually did a kind of a tuning of our thermal desktop model. So we have, a good thermal desktop model of OreSat, including the cards and the frames and the solar panels and things like that. Okay. Okay, so no questions so far. No questions? Questions? Okay, I'll move on. So here's our... I know I have one. Here we go. Yeah, good. Here's our tri-band turnstile antenna. We're very proud of this. It's got a lot of antennas in a little space. We've got UHF downlink, L-band uplink, so that's 1.265 gigahertz uplink, and then L1 for GPS. And this is circular right hand, and mostly omnidirectional. And it looks like this when it's all bundled up for flight, which is super cute, right? And just like you guys, we use meltwire. So this is monofilament fishing line that goes under a 3-watt industrial rated ceramic burn resistor, right? And we've not seen a failure yet of this, which is super cool. So we feel really good about it. And the little tape measures do a really good job of curling up in there. And then when you release them, there's no debris, right? You can see right here. You can see the when it melts, it just leaves these guys. And then this is the doors that open up to.
Well, I actually have a technical question.
Yeah.
Do you all have a deployment sensor, or do you just burn for a like a predetermined amount of time?
So we wanted a deployment sensor, and we think we're now stupid for not having one. But we just burn for a predetermined amount of time. And it turns out built into our radio section is the ability to see if the antennas were deployed, because we've got a forward backwards SWR measurement system. And so if our forward
Oh, on
SWR,
board.
yeah, If our forward SWR is really bad, we know that the antennas haven't deployed. Now, we don't have any code for that to deal with it, but that's a possibility of sensing. But what we really wanted was just a couple of not even switches, but IR distance sensors that show us that the doors got opened, right? So
Yeah.
well,
This is so that's actually what we do right now on cruise. I think the part number is like the VLX 6180 or something. It's like a
yeah, sure.
$10 IR distance sensor, and really happy with it. We have like a smart burn thing where it only burns until it detects the antennas have moved and then it stops.
Super smart. I love it. Yeah. And we talked about, putting those on the end caps. So it would block it basically. We'd see the antenna come out. That is something in the year 2000, we'll do that, but for now, we didn't.
Well, maybe we can port you guys and make a pull request.
Yeah, absolutely. That would be amazing. I mean, one of the things we did for this whole damn project is we were hoping that people who are smarter than we are, would actually, add stuff to the damn satellite. So here is the OreSat. So that was OreSat 0, which is the tri-band. We couldn't fit the tri-band on OreSat 0.5, the one we just handed off, because there's a giant lens in the middle of a damn minus Z end cap. We had to fly this stupid ass shortwave infrared camera. Ugh, the worst. And so now we had to go to monopole. So here's a L-band monopole, and here's a UHF monopole, but the same deployer thing, right? So you can see it just, we curl it in here, and then we've got little doors, and it goes from there. But where are the little doors? Oh, they're down there. Anyway, so this worked great. Vibe tests, whatever. You guys do vibe tests. So here's the back plane. So the thing to know about the back plane is that we just dump the battery voltage directly into the back plane. So we have two lithium ion batteries in series. So it's a 2S pack. And that gives us 7.2 volts nominal. It goes from 6.0 is our discharge minimum voltage, all the way up to, of course, 8.2 volts. Sorry, 4 volts. I can do that. No, 4.1, 8.2. Sorry. So yeah, that's true. 6.0 to 8.2 volts. And we have two independent battery packs on one battery card. So it's kind of technically 2S, 2P, but not really, because it's really just 2S back to back. So here you can kind of see inside there, you see the 18650 cells. They're from, oh my God, Toshiba, I think. We've got the part number in the Google Drive. And they're good. Of course, we have to have the Kapton battery heaters on them, because of course you can't go below 0 degrees C. And then those ta they have tabs, and they're literally welded in, sorry, soldered into the tabs are welded on the cells, but then we solder the cells directly onto the circuit board. That's what those are. So we've got it, and we have a little bit of a strain relief. We kind of go up through the board, then down, and solder it once it's down. It's very good. We've never had a failure. And then we've got, the standard stuff, and I'll go over that in a minute. Okay, so 7.2 volts. The other thing we've got on this bus is the OreSat power domain. So the only thing that automatically comes on is our onboard computer called the C3. That's the only thing that automatically powers up no matter what. Everything else is off and has to be turned on by the C3 using the OreSat power domain. And this turns out to be really, really important and powerful because we're really able to reduce power when we're in standby mode charging the batteries because everything's off. It's also really important because other stuff can't screw us up, right? We can always know that we can shut down misbehaving cards if there's a short or if there's anything else like that. We unfortunately use the controller area network, which is a giant mistake, but there's still nothing better right now, which makes me sad. The CAN bus is 1 megabit per second serial bus for those who don't know it. It's an automotive bus. It sucks beans. We hate it. Did I mention we hate it? And we're stuck with it because there's nothing better yet. Eventually, single pair Ethernet will eat CAN's lunch, I hope, or at least in this in the CubeSat world. But for now, we're stuck with CAN. We all and we'll talk.
Oh, okay, can I actually come in with another technical question here? Do you think, Andrew, that there could be, I guess it was a bit of a complex question. Do you think there could be any place for like basically like trying to bit bang like Ethernet with an FPGA? Because there are some lower, not low, but lower cost like
Lower
FPGA
cost,
modules coming online.
but not lower power. That's the problem. So so we flew an amateur avionics system in our rocket before we built the CubeSat that uses Ethernet. And the problem with Ethernet right now is you need a switch for it to work really. And so we built us our own custom switch on a circuit board for the rocket, and it was fun, and we loved it. And oh my God, Ethernet, it was the best thing ever. But the power budget for that is insane. And then your microcontrollers that are usually sucking, 10 or 20 milliamps are now sucking 40 or 50 or 100 milliamps to run Ethernet. So what you need is you need a low power peripheral with a driver that does the single pair Ethernet. And then at that point, yes, I think that we'll be switching over to Ethernet. But these microcontrollers already have Ethernet built into them. So you don't need an extra on the outside. You can just use the variant that has Ethernet. So, and yes, you do need CPLDs and FPGAs to interface your microcontrollers or whatever with, weird custom hardware, but you need to avoid that for your main bus because it's just going to eat your power alive. So, and I we did trade studies back in 2015, 2016 on this, which is why I know this, but I'd have to go dig them up to give you examples. But single pair Ethernet, SPE, is just coming out and people are just realizing this is the best thing ever. So I'm hopeful that OreSat 5 will be single pair Ethernet.
All right, well, cool. Yeah, it's something that we're kind of keeping an eye on our side too.
Yeah, it's good. It's good. We should ditch CAN as soon as possible. So, okay, a couple of things here. We have besides the CAN and the OreSat power domain, we also have a shutdown circuit. So one of the things we're really, really worried about is latch up. And the only way to deal with latch up is to power cycle literally everything. So if you ground a shutdown, the shutdown pin, which is the first pin on this bus here, the entire satellite bricks. In a good way. It power cycle, it crowbars down to zero. Everything, even the battery pack, disconnects. And at that point, there's only one circuit that's powered, and that's by capacitors, and that's our radiation tolerant watchdog timer. So we have one radiation tolerant part. It's $150. It's a quad comparator, and it runs this timing circuit where if you don't pet the watchdog, because you don't kick the watchdog, that's like old 1970s talk. You pet the watchdog because it's adorable and you like the watchdog. Sorry, that was terrible. This radiation tolerant part basically can take down the entire satellite and power cycle it. And we do that once a day, which I think is a good thing to do. Okay. Here's the aux connector because everybody wants something different. And you can again bespoke make a black backplane for each mission. Oh, so yeah, so thanks to Oshpark. Oshpark supports us. That's why all of our damn circuit boards are purple. Okay. So battery pack, talk to you about this. I can pull up the circuit board, the schematic if you guys want. Oh, someone's talking to me, chat. Sorry, I can't see chat. I watched up. I can pull up the schematic if you want. And what we have here is we've got two kinds of nodes on OreSat. We have the Linux nodes and we have the microcontroller nodes. The battery pack is a microcontroller node. So it's got an STM32F091, which is the smallest microcontroller you can get with CAN on board that still has decent memory and enough pins. And that's what that guy is right there. And then we have a max, oh my God, something, 27 something. I don't remember what it is. No, a max 7000 series fuel gauge that also cell balances. And I kind of hate that chip. That chip has been kind of a thorn in our side. It's not the best chip ever. I'd like to change it with something better, but for right now, there's nothing better. So that's what we just flew in OreSat 0.5. If anybody wants a good electrical engineering stuff and project and they're interested in batteries, then I'd love to talk to you about revving this board with a better fuel gauge system that's not the stupid ass max. We also, one of our deep regrets is putting our inhibit switches in the rails. So you can see them right here. On here, you can see them right here. And what they look like on the outside is they look like holes. That top hole is where our inhibit switches come out. And it works, but on about 60% of the deployers we've encountered, it gets hooked on the door system coming out because they never expect you to have things pushing against the rails. And so as it slides out, there's like a divot in the rail for a connector or a fastener or something. And our things go chunk and they go into the divot and the satellite is stuck. So for our space flight deployment on an astro rocket, we had to remove two of our inhibit switches, which sucked. And on the momentous flight, we had to remove one of them. It was just like it's just stupid, right? Fortunately for us, ExoLaunch made the right deployer, and it's got this beautiful, smooth deployer rail, so it worked just perfectly with ExoLaunch. So, and that's how it should be because it says you can do this in the CubeSat specification. It's just a bit giant pain because nobody in the deployer world takes note of that. So that's on the other hand. If I could go back in time, I'd do something different. I don't know what I'd do though, because it's so incredibly convenient to have the deployer. This is the deployer thing right here, the inhibit switches right on your battery pack and not have to have wires and not have to have anything. You know, maybe, I don't know, maybe I'd choose this again, despite the pain and suffering. Solar modules, I showed you guys these before, two Spectralab cells. Never, ever, ever going with Spectralab cells again because Spectralab hates us for our freedoms or something. I really, really dislike them. We've tried to order cells three times since we got our original batch and they've basically blown us off. So if you guys know of a good gallium arsenide, 30% efficient, you know, sort of 27 centimeter squared cell equivalent, we want to know about it. Here's the cells. And you know we RTV it. That's you can see some of the red bits there. We basically RTV it down and then solder on tabs to it. What we're really really pleased about is on the back you'll see all this crap. That is an STM32, so it's a little microcontroller node. And sorry, it's over here. That's what that is. And over here is a maximum PowerPoint tracker. And it's a real maximum PowerPoint tracker. It's not a maximum PowerPoint controller, which is a fake maximum PowerPoint tracker that does not work in real systems. So this is a software-controlled MPPT. There's a lot of really interesting firmware work to do on this that we have not had time for. So if anybody's interested in doing like, you know, firmware work on, you know, maximum PowerPoint trackers for solar arrays, this would be a good project for you to have. And again, it's all published. It's all out there. You can just jump on it. And I think it's got a really, really cool circuit for the maximum PowerPoint tracker, which is kind of fun. Anyway, I am proud of a couple things on this damn satellite. Okay. Oops, someone said something in the chat. Yeah, they are a Boeing company. That doesn't help them at all. In fact, they got worse when they got bought by Boeing. Okay, so let's talk about the C3. Let me grab one. Okay, so the C3 is our main processor. This is actually wrong, so ignore it. We had a really interesting problem, and since you guys are students, I'll tell you about it as a learning mechanism. So this board that you see right here, this is the version 5. It's got an STM32 F439, which is the largest F series. Well, now back then it was anyway. F439. It runs a real-time operating system, and it runs our radio. So our L-band receiver is this guy here, and our UHF transceiver, both TX and RX, is right here. And it runs those radios. So this microcontroller also runs not only the whole satellite and the OreSat power domain, but also CCSDS communication stuff. We had one graduate student who did this for us, did the firmware for us, and did an amazing job. It's beautiful. It's some of the most beautiful code I've ever seen written in C. And it was absolutely and completely untenable to have undergraduates you add to it, right? By the time an undergraduate had learned how to do all the stuff in the real-time operating system, ChibiOS, if you know that, and CCSDS and all the stuff that's all really, really tightly interlinked, they graduated, or they were gone, or they went insane. And so we switched our entire flight computer over to a Linux box. So this is the current C3, and it runs an Octavo Cortex A8, which is a BeagleBone equivalent, if you know the BeagleBone series of single board computers. And that is a 1 gigahertz Cortex A8 that runs Linux off of that eMMC card that's right there, embedded multi-module card. Yes, we have an SD card, a micro SD card, but that's just for development. We don't fly that. We run off the eMMC and then run off that. So now we can program in Python, and we've moved most of our hard development to Python. And in 2 months of having this, we got more done than having, that other system for 2 years. So it was a really important and interesting, appropriate technology choice because it was bad for power, it was bad for reliability, it was bad for so many reasons, but it was the right thing for a student group that had a big resource constraint on inexperienced firmware engineers. And I still say it's the right thing.
Bit of a question here, Andrew. Have you guys had to change? Well, so like one of the big drawbacks of Python versus C is no memory management, right? Are you concerned at all about that with regards to like single event upsets, or is it just a fuck it, fly it sort of situation?
Yes, we have adopted the CPP development philosophy of FAFO, fuck around,
Yes.
find out.
Yeah.
And no, so you're not wrong, right? Flying a Linux box as your main controller has its drawbacks, and we will tell you at the end of the OreSat 0.5 mission if that was a major mistake. So far, it's had the benefits have way outweighed the costs, right? But that's in flat sat and in testing. So in the real world, we'll see how many times it resets a day, right? But hopefully it'll be okay. Other people have flown Beagle boards with some success, so there's some hope. Okay.
Oh, sorry. I just wanted to add one more thing to this. I think it's an interesting thing to keep track of because I know that Max Holliday and all of his satellites that he's flying for NASA, he is adamant on keeping those CircuitPython. But I will also say, like, all of the Pi 4 satellites that launched in April are now dead. So whether that's his fault or Python's fault, who knows? We're probably not going to get a report, but like we tried to check on them the other week, and we're like, oh, yeah, they stopped transmitting for a while. So, yeah,
Wow, that's fascinating.
it is. It is. I need to email him and be like, "What's up, man?" He occasionally answers my GitHub issues, so
Yeah,
maybe
okay.
I can just get through to him that way.
That's fascinating. Yeah, I'd love to know, actually. So let's go over the C3 board just a little bit. So here, yeah, I don't know if you guys can see that. I hope you can. Let me see if I can make this bigger. Can I pin myself so I can see what the hell I'm doing? No, I can't. Never mind. Never mind. Okay, so those giant caps run that chip right there. That is our watchdog timer. And those are the capacitors that keep it up while the whole power cycle, the whole satellite is power cycled. What else is there? So there's the L-band radio, which is what this guy is right here. It's based on the AX5043, which is now end of life. So we're looking for our next radio, but we're going to fly AX5043 for the time being because we've got 50 of them, and that should be plenty for everything we need to do. And it's really painful to switch your radio chip. What else can I tell you about this? Some OreSat power domain. It's got these giant transistors on it. We actually put the circuits to blow the resistors on this board. If I could re-architect things, I would probably move a bunch of stuff off of this board. I might move the radios to a separate daughter board. This is our most complicated board, and it literally takes 12 hours of constant work to stuff ourselves. Now, of course, on a machine, we had this one was stuffed by Screaming Circuits, which is a local company that does prototyping assembly. It took them 2 days, right? So it was like easy schmeasy, but because it was on like literally 2 days for everything. For us, it was like 12 hours of meticulously putting each per you know putting the solder mask on or solder paste on and putting tweezers down. And only like 50% of them worked. So it's doable to build it yourself, but you don't want to. So I'd like to make this simpler so it's easier to build. One of the other principles of our group is that a student group should be able to build it, right? You might need the infrastructure of a CNC machine for the frames and a easy bake oven, like a Controleo or something to bake the boards, but you should be able to do it in-house.
Andrew, hopping in again. I think Inez is asking if you can spotlight yourself. Just so your feed stays up.
Pin? Does that
Pin,
work?
or I think pin just does it for you. I think if you spotlight yourself, then it does it for everyone because you're the
Spot
host.
one. Your video for everyone. There we go. I think that worked.
Hopefully.
Yep, thank you. I did not know about that.
Second question.
Yeah.
So do you have any moral or technical qualms with the Chinese, specifically Chinese PCB manufacturing?
Some of my best friends. No, not at all.
Okay. Because something that we might do for you guys is specifically for the C3, because we're interested in forking it, is I think the main roadblock to being able to do a C3 in China right now, like at JLC or something, is they probably don't have all the parts. But we could
Yeah.
stock the parts for you, like consign them,
Yeah.
and then we could run a supply chain through there so we can keep getting like professionally assembled boards rather than having to resort to free undergraduate labor. So we're outsourcing the sweatshop from Portland to Shenzhen.
Yeah,
But
it's and
yeah, I think that's something we could do for you guys.
yeah, no, I think it would be great. We've actually done that on our reaction wheel boards specifically. So the reason that we kind of did this is that we just feel like the open source ethos is that it should simplify these boards so that it's easier. But you're right, no student group should fly boards that they made unless you're really good at this themselves. Now we fly boards that we stuffed ourselves, but I'll humble brag and say that we're good at it. We've got a lot of experience of doing sophisticated surface mount parts and testing them and inspecting them and stuff like that. But in general, unless you've got a really sophisticated EE team, you want to have them professionally made for sure. And also make sure you get them made with lead and not Rojas because you don't want enough lead in space.
I feel like one of the other things too is like now that the C3 has a big BGA package, like it makes a lot more sense to have that done professionally.
That's right. Now, the BGA package is huge. It's a 0.8 millimeter BGA, but at the same time, you are right. It's better to have it professionally made. We feel much more comfortable that all of our C3 version 6s were made by Screaming Circuits. So, and by the way, the boards themselves, there's two kinds of boards. There's a four-layer board and there's a two-layer board. And then we have one six-layer board, which is the reaction wheel boards, but we're going to hopefully switch those back to four layers soon. Again, trying to reduce cost and trying to reduce complexity. But you can do these boards. These are Oshkosh boards again, but you can do these boards with any manufacturer. And again, JLC PCB did our last run of reaction wheels for us, reaction wheel controller boards, which is super cool. Okay, oh, I keep missing chats. Okay. Why are the reaction wheels six layers? Because we're stupid. I'll get to those guys in a second and you'll see why we're stupid. Okay. That was a C3 board. Okay, so one of the things that's really important for us is that we onboard people easily. So there's two onboarding development kits. One is the nuclear board for the STM32s. That allows students to onboard the tools and ChibiOS and C development and all that kind of stuff in CAN Open. We use the CAN Open stack to program the STM32s. And we use the Pocket Beagle to allow people to get used to programming the octave chip. So, talk about software for just a minute. So, on the big guys, the octave boards, we've got Debian Linux. That's made by the BeagleBone core folk. On top of that, we've got our own Python framework called the OreSat Linux Application Framework, or OLAF. And OLAF is the interface between your code on your card and the CAN bus. So we use something called CAN Open. And CAN Open is both amazing and terrible all at the same time. And it's a certain way to look at your data. Basically, it's how you identify your data packets, because CAN is kind of a strange bus. And it's, do I regret using it? I am super, super ambivalent. On one hand, it's amazing. On one hand, it is very difficult to understand and use. So it's 50-50. If you're going to use a CAN bus, I guess I'd recommend using CAN Open, but I'm not even sure. So we've got our own OLAF framework that our own Python code runs in. And so it's OLAF is the interface to the rest of the CAN bus. On board our STM32s, we run ChibiOS, which is a small real-time operating system that one day we hope to replace with Zephyr. We run CAN Open Node, which is an open source C-based CAN Open library. And then we have the C apps running on top of that. We have one repository for every Linux-based card, and we have one repository for all of the firmware cards. So OreSat-firmware is all of our STM32s. And then we have dash soft. If you see a repo called dash software, it's our Linux cards. And we have kind of a sophisticated system. I hope anyway. It seems terrible to us right now, but we have an image builder that builds images. We have a builder that builds Debian packages of the different custom applications. And that way, when we send over-the-air updates, we send Debian packages, and then we just use apt to uninstall the Debian packages. And that seems to work and seems to do the right thing. And so that we're very pleased about that. And it's way more complicated than that. I'm not going to get into software because there's lots to talk about with software. But for example, if you were going to write reaction wheel code to run the reaction wheels, the control theory for that, you would write that in Python, you would talk to OLAF, and then you talk to the reaction wheels on the other end of the CAN bus using OLAF and using parts of CAN Open. And it's relatively simple. Like, we have a mechanical engineer who's doing it right now, and he's doing just fine dealing with Python and dealing with CAN Open stuff in OLAF. So on every single one of our boards, we have this flat flexible connector. And that flat flexible connector goes to one of these boards. That's called the card debug board. And what it's got on it is an STM32 ST link. So that's how we program the STM32 microcontrollers. And it's got a virtual COM port. So that's how we talk to the Linux over serial. And it's got this USB. And this USB is kind of cool. This USB goes through here, through the FFC, and then directly to our Linux boards. So we can talk USB directly to those Linux boxes, the Octavo chips. And that allows us to come have those USBs come up as USB peripherals, as Ethernet peripherals. So we can plug our Linux cards into our system. Let's see if we got one here. Yeah, let me bring you over for a second. So here's FlatSat, right? And this is going to be super awkward. I'm sorry. I wish I could do this better, but I don't know how. Maybe I could do this. All right. Can you guys hear me? I hope. Yeah. Okay. So here's FlatSat. I'll take you on a quick tour. This is our 2U OreSat. So this is 0.5 engineering unit right now. And you can see all the different cards, right? Here's our star tracker. This is our C3 card right here. It's attached using this guy. That goes to one of those car debug boards. That goes to this USB hub up here. And that goes to this Linux computer. So this is a computer you can log in remotely through a VPN. And now you can actually come over here. So this computer is running this, but you can run this from your own computer. There you go. And this is the C3 card. So the C3 card is actually hosting a web page. And you can go to the beacon and send a beacon. You can go to the node manager and turn on any of these nodes. And for example, right now it's saying battery one is currently on, C3 card is on, and all the rest of these guys are off. Oh, and apparently the C. Oh, yeah. Look at that. CFC is someone turned the CFC card on. I did not do that. Right down there. So that's cool. And this also allows you to play with all sorts of things. There's a log, so you can just see what the latest Linux logs are. This is amazing for debug, just amazing. Now, you can't get this in space, right? But for FlatSat, each one of our Linux cards allows us to get that. And for the non-Linux cards, we again use the little STM32 virtual COM port to talk to the serial port. So we get a serial stream coming out of our little tiny microcontroller nodes. Yeah, and then I'll get to the rest of this later. So it's important to see FlatSat back here. Each one of these is a port for a card. We've got the engineering unit up now, so you don't see it, but usually there's a card in each one of these things, and that's why it's FlatSat, because we want to be able to poke at each of the cards. Okay. Oh, hey, look at that. So there's FlatSat. And that is, you can, so here's like star tracker, experiment board, our GPS, and our onboard computer, the C3. And each one of them has a car debug attached to it. And you can just see it's flat and open. That was our OreSat 0, our 1U FlatSat. Okay, so just real quickly, I'll just run over this because I want to get back to the tech. We flew this in March 2022. Those are literally every single card that we flew. We used a clean box to keep it clean. And yeah, that was everything right before we bundled up for flight, which was literally like the day before we flew, which is really cool for handoff. We abuse high school students. So these are high school students we abused. There's like on that OreSat 0, there was like 300 of those M2 screws. Yeah, they did that, which was mean, but hilarious too. There we are. It's ready, all wrapped up for flight. It was Oregon's first satellite, so that's cute. She flies with her own wings, is the Oregon state motto. Hey, Oliver. Hey, sorry, I'm giving a lecture or whatever this is, workshop, I guess. That's great. It's cute. us loading it in. We were on an Astra launch vehicle, which Michael can tell you all about because, oh my God, we can't believe it actually made it. There were seven failures, a success, a failure, and then we flew. We're a failure. Yeah, we were successful.
Yeah, you guys were the first success. And I think only one of four payloads that actually made it away.
Yeah, and then they flew it again for the last time and it failed, and then they stopped flying them.
Yeah, right after you guys, we were helping the Berkeley team with CubeSat with a Q, and that went straight to the bottom of the Atlantic. Very sad. Yeah.
I'll skip that, skip that, skip that. Oh, so really, and actually, this is kind of interesting for you guys. So, OreSat Zero was in a dusk to dawn orbit, right? What that means is that it's got a LTDN of 6 a.m., and so it's always in the sun all the time, right? So, if you guys are the sun, we're going around like this in a sun synchronous orbit, which is amazing. It was like we call it the T-shirt orbit. We were 19 degrees C in space in Leo and never budged. It was amazing. And our battery packs were 100% full all the time. They ignored the 75%. It really was 100%. And the battery voltage never got below 8.1 volts. It was crazy nuts, easy orbit, which is actually a little sad because we really wanted something that was like for our first satellite that was a little more challenging. But it worked fine. So we got 2 weeks of really good data from OreSat Zero. It shut up after 2 weeks because we have positive transmitter control. So if it doesn't hear from us, and after 2 weeks it shuts up. So we had to build our ground station. So you guys know sat nogs. If you don't know sat nogs, you need to go look up sat nogs and understand sat nogs. Point is, global ground station, receive only, amazing. We got all of our data through sat nogs, but it's receive only. And so we had to build on top of sat nogs. So we've got the university class open ground station, or UniClogs. You guys are building one, which is fantastic. It is the best name ever, not the worst name ever. And it's like anywhere between 10 and 25K for a good one. It's all SDR based, and of course it transmits, right? Oh, and we have best icon ever. It's a unicorn with a helical antenna as a thing. Ring clogs. Here's version two. That's what we're building right this very second. We moved to a dish for L-band and S-band and future X-band and UHF, and we got rid of the VHF because nobody uses VHF anymore. So, and there you guys are. Tail polyphonic. Yay. Stuff, ignoring that. So we didn't hear back from OreSat Zero. It just continued to shut up. And so we found out that our goddamn faculty advisor came in and fixed one of the crappy node ground nodes on the low noise amplifier. Because I mean, look at that. Does that not look like a stupid node, like stupid ground? Like that's a bad ground circuit, right? You should flood fill it like this, like someone did. That was me. And of course, this is an inductor, and it was very carefully tuned. And so when I screwed it up, everything became an oscillator. And so our main L-band uplink was jammed. And it turns out that our secondary, we have a UHF receiver as well as a backup. There was a firmware bug, and that's off. And not only was it 20 dB down because there was no LNA, but it was really 35 dBm down because when that was off, it also ate the circuit, it ate the signal. It wasn't just off, it was very much a resistor. So we needed something that was like 90 kilowatts to talk to the damn thing. And so we were crying, big crying. And thought, could we get a big dish? And of course, the big dish came to our rescue. Stanford Research Institute was nice enough to allow us to use that. And lo and behold, we nuked our satellite with like a megawatt class signal, and it came back up. And so this was 8 months later. Everything was fine. It had just been working fine for 8 months. And so that was really good for us because we knew we could work in space for at least 8 months. And we're going to try and do this again. Because or say it's been more than 2 years now, and so on year three, sometime probably this fall, we really, really want to do this again and just see how it's doing. And now we have a hack to set the time to a negative value, so it transmits for a year instead of 2 weeks, which is funny. So it's coming down, and yeah, again, we like to joke that we'll be Oregon's first meteor shower as well as first satellite. Okay, so 0.5. So now, OreSat zero tumbling in space. No ADCS system, no nothing. Got some magnetometers, but we can't turn them on because we can't get a software patch up to it. So kind of done, right? So OreSat 0.5 is our next technology demonstrator. It's OreSat 0 plus an S-band helical antenna for an S-band Wi-Fi from space experiment. It's got a shortwave infrared camera on the bottom. And then most importantly for you guys, it's got tetrahedral reaction wheels that we built ourselves and a three-axis magnetorquer kit. So it's our first attempt at attitude determination and control. We have a star tracker, which is a simple camera. We are using University of Washington's lost LOST star tracking code. And so far it seems to be working. So we have a working star tracker, which is nice for some definition of working. We have a GPS receiver. It does not use a Venus anymore. It's still a Skytrack, but it's the Skytrack Orions now. I got to update this damn presentation. And we do have a software-defined radio GPS receiver on here as well, but that's going to require a software patch. If you are interested in pain and suffering and GPS, then this is a great, great, great software-only project to get our software-defined radio up and GPS receiver up and running. And we'll help you with it, but GPS is just a nightmare to do from scratch. Okay, so let me go grab a couple of our magnetorquers. Hold on.
Any questions or anything while Andrew is away? Cool.
So here's the Z-axis magnetorquer, right? This just fits right in there. If I go back up, you can see it right here. That's this thing, right? And then we didn't have room to do anything intelligent, so we made this terrible thing where that picture's actually wrong. We didn't have room to do that, so we made a cross. We took a sheet of permalloy and we machined it on a router, which was a terrible, awful thing to do. And then we wrapped it. And so we actually have a cross that fits on the inside of this as a single unit. So hold on. So this whole thing fits inside here. And that's our magnetorquer. If I could go back in time, I might not do that X-axis thing. I might do something with just air core and call it good. Reaction wheels. Let me grab one. Hold on. Sorry. I want to show you guys. Well, as always, I can't actually find what I'm looking for. So maybe that's it. Oh yeah. There we go. Okay. So what we did for reaction wheels is we took these things at a 45 degree angle. No, it's like 33. I don't remember what the degree angle is. We took four of these. This is based off a paper, the very famous SmallSat paper, I believe it was, about using four wheels so you could lose one and still have three-axis control. Because we're going to lose a wheel for sure. And so we made these beams that go across here. And let me show you that. So in the satellite, see if I can get some more light on this. There we go. Hopefully that's helpful. Yeah, that may be too bright. That's not terrible. Okay, so here is the reaction wheel right there. And you can see it spins a little bit, and you can see the control wheel right above that, or the control board right above that. And this thing over here is a what we call the beam. So we've got two reaction wheels to a beam, and then the beam goes on either side of the satellite. This array. Back we go. So here's a beam. It's custom machined from hubs and anodized black, just like the rest of OreSat. This is one of our reaction wheels. And what you'll see is on the inside of the reaction wheel is a black hubs machined spindle. And then that core, that DC brushless core, that was stolen, or I should say heavily modified from a drone motor. So we bought an, oh God, Ecomax 1106 motor, a little teeny tiny drone motor for the smallest kinds of drones. And we gutted it. And we took the stator, which is this guy, and we routed it. And we actually, you can kind of see it's a little difficult to see, but the wires come out, go through little channels, and come out. And then we put that whole thing inside using two hybrid bearings. So silica nitride bearings with stainless steel races on both sides. So we've got two in there. And then that is just works with quotes for the for with quotes for works. And oh, I should show you the inside too. So we took the rotor from that and we machined it down, and we just, 3M 2216 glued it into a custom machined thing. So it's a commercial off-the-shelf motor hacked into a custom reaction wheel. And a couple things, we did a FAFO on this. We think that these are probably way, way, way too heavy and way, way, way too powerful for what we need for OreSat 0.5. They're probably cleared up for a 6U, but we don't know because we just did it. We were just in a rush and we just did it. So we've got four of these things on the satellite. Each of these goes to a custom circuit board. And now I'm going to pull up our 3D CAD.
Question while you're bringing this up, Andrew, is there any kind of like grounding? Like, are you worried at all about like the wheels or any part of that assembly just getting charged up, and then not being able to like shuffle the charge around?
No, and the reason for that is because it's inside the satellite, and so I'm not really particularly worried. It's brass. It is pretty well isolated with those silicon nitride bearings, actually. So maybe I should be more worried about it, but I'm not, because we're inside the satellite. I don't see a charging mechanism for charging it, and if it zapped, it would zap across the reaction wheels. Sorry, the it would zap across the silicon nitride bearings, and that's not going to help hurt the silicon nitride bearings. So the worst case is we'd get static discharge zaps across the bearing race, and it would pit the bearing race, but not badly. So yeah, I think I don't care. Yeah, it's a good, that's a great question though. I don't think we ever actually I don't think we ever actually considered that.
Well, I bring it up just because I think from the literature I've read, like charging is actually one of the most common failure modes for reaction wheels.
Is that
Where
true?
like all
Shit.
it's believed to be, I think, yeah, because like they acquire charge
through whatever mechanism, and then you get a zap across the bearings, and the
Yeah.
bearings and then they stop working. Because like the root for this, I can find a paper next to it. It's pretty interesting. But like
You
Kepler
should.
years ago, like went down be and they correlated when the wheels went down with CMEs, and they were like,
Yeah.
oh yeah, I guess you can pick up a lot of charge from CMEs. Anyway, total aside, but
Yeah,
yeah,
so
cool.
if we go down because of CMEs, I'm going to declare success.
Yeah. You did so well that the sun had to smack
That's
you
right.
down.
So here again, here's the magnet torquers. You can see how the magnet torquers fit inside of the reaction wheels. We got really desperate for room, so we did that. Again, not a great choice, but it makes a really compact ADCS unit, so that's good, I guess. And then let me open this guy up in a new. Where's open? Open the document. Oh no, I don't want this. I want the actual assembly wheel. There we go. Okay. So, oh God, this is old. This is not even supposed to exist. What the hell? What branch am I on? Am I on? Oh, yeah. Okay. Sorry. I'm on the wrong branch. Sorry, hold on. Let me find out where it is. There we go. That's what I want. So there's the actual reaction wheel mock-up. Let me just section that so you can just take a quick view on the inside. So ignore all the mates. So here's the two hybrid bearings. There's the stator. There's the rotor, the magnets. There's our custom part. And on the very top, we have a little teeny tiny magnet that's centered in this a little aluminum ring here. And that is how we sense where the motor is, because on the outside is. This reaction wheel is attached to the beam only from here. It spins, and this board here actually has a little magnetic position sensor that can go up to about 60,000 RPMs. And so now we have the exact position of the rotor, even at high speeds. That allows us to do field-oriented control if we want to, and we do that a little bit at low speeds, and that's great. And then we ran into a problem, which is that our board was too complicated and too small. And so you ask, why was this a six-layer board? It's a six-layer board because it just got too complicated and too dense. There's all sorts of power electronics on here to run the motor. And then we didn't even have time. We didn't have enough room for the microcontroller. So the microcontroller is on this board. So we did a little mezzanine stack up. And we just grossly misjudged the amount of room that we needed for the reaction wheel control. And even then, the card below us, what we call the ADCS card, it's got a gyro on it, and it's got a bunch of OreSat power domains on it. And each one of these wheels has its own OreSat power domain, and we didn't have room to put the power domains on the reaction wheel boards, so we actually put them on the card below it, and then we have a flat flexible cable up to the. Oh, it's not shown here. Oh, I thought we had that in there already. Anyway, this board down here, this is the ADCS board, and then there's a flat flexible cable from here to down to the ADCS card. And on the ADCS card is the OreSat power domain that runs it, turns it on and off, and all that kind of stuff. But the main reaction wheel controller is on this. And from the C3's point of view, it doesn't care about any of this, right? All it sees is the CAN bus, and it sees set of commands it can send to the CAN bus to set parameters inside each of these reaction wheels. So there's velocity control mode and torque control mode and some other modes that run on these right now. And these, you can control them, they do rotate, but right now we have no control theory to actually run them. Okay. There we go. That was the ADCS system. In all of its glory. And I think that's actually all I need to say. The rest of this is our mission. This is our science mission that we flew on a balloon. And yeah, skip over this. Now, we got to fly on an ER2, which is kind of fun, which is the old spy plane. And this is kind of an adorable thing. I'll just talk about this for a second. So this is that what high school kids are going to buy or build, excuse me. From a kid or themselves, doesn't matter, it's open source. And it's basically an S-band Wi-Fi receiver. And we've tested it and sort of works. And basically we point OreSat at them and we beam live video from space down to them. They receive it and broadcast it to local smart devices. And it's cool because we've got this Schmidt-Cassegrain telescope ground by hand for us by a guy in the Netherlands. There's a great YouTube video from Huygens Optics on this. So if you look up tiny space telescope, you'll find a nice article on this, which is cute. And that will be
Cool. Oh,
good.
I was just going to ask. So is DX Wi-Fi like part of the OreSat 0.5? Like did it make it?
Yeah, it did. Yep.
Cool.
Yeah, which is really great. And so, okay, so that's my presentation. And I'll show you what couple more things. So if you look down on the Z-axis, God, where is it? Right there. That camera right there, that's the DX Wi-Fi camera or the OreSat Live camera on the DX Wi-Fi board. So that actually is going to be a 1 watt S-band Wi-Fi transmitter from space, which is cool. And it's kind of hard to see because of that, but I'm not even going to bother to show it. But at the very bottom is that SWIR camera that we also flew. So there you go. These little guys right here are just 3D printed plus X feet so that we can put the satellite in a little holder. We have a lot of other cards that you'll see lying around. Like this guy right here is one of these. It's basically just a card extender so we can plug an OreSat backplane assembly into FlatSat because right now we're running the whole system off the power supply. Eventually, we'll be running the whole system off of this. So one of the things that we're really excited about is our testing infrastructure. So this guy right here is a OreSat solar simulator. There's a solar panel underneath there of halogens and UV LEDs and red LEDs and blue LEDs. And that makes an AM01 sun to run the solar panel. So eventually FlatSat will actually be solar powered, which I think is the right way to do it. Right. Nobody asked me any questions. Except for Michael. So there you go. There's the technical overview. And now I can dive into any of the systems that you want me to dive into, although it is 3:20, so that's been an hour and a half almost. Let me unpin myself.
Yeah, does anyone else want to ask for like elaboration or questioning or anything? I can keep at it asking leading questions, but yeah, it would be nice if anyone who has any burning questions is able to voice them now.
Oh,
Can I
yes.
ask you? Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
I was just gonna ask if you could just give a little more like information about kind of your thought process behind the magnetorquer design, and you were saying like in the future you would probably go with like an air core design, stuff like that. Like our team is interested in trying to develop one, but it would again be a super small profile. So I'm just curious kind of what that process looked like for you.
Yeah, the process was we did the right thing. And when we originally designed this, it was this, right? Which we have no problem with. Again, one of the things that really constrains OreSat is this card cage system, right? So it's not like you can have a big vertical magnetorquer in the in this card case, right? So we knew we had to have the Z-axis had to be an air coil kind of thing like this, right? So that's fine. And then when we came to this, we actually had two separate rods and we had them stacked on top of each other. And then because of that mezzanine on the reaction wheel, it didn't fit and we couldn't get it to fit in any sense of the word. And so we went to this system where we machined out the across of the material, which escapes me now. What the hell is it called? I can't remember the name of it. Sorry, it's the standard stuff you'd make cores, magnetotor cores out of. Low permalloy. That's it. Low permittivity, and soft material, so you don't get a residual magnetic field, right? So we machined it, and it worked. But machining this stuff is a super pain in the ass. It's really dirty, and it's makes terrible chips and stuff like that. So that was painful. If you have a little router that can do aluminum, then you can do this. But it's I'm not sure it's worth it. And getting the plates from AliExpress was a little nerve-wracking because it's not like, you're not guaranteed to really get a permalloy. So if it were me, I might reduce the diameter of this and go to two solenoidal core, wheels, and just reduce the cross-sectional area of this, which will reduce it, but that's fine. I think that would be easier. Sometimes you have to sacrifice performance for ease of building, right? So, and I'm not sure that. I still have not totally convinced that this is buying us a lot more. I want someone to run the numbers, and I don't have any physics majors to run the numbers right now. So on some future redesign, I want someone to actually write a real article, a white paper on why do you want a core and what does it buy you and all that kind of stuff. Someone asked about cleanliness. So we're very much anti-cleanliness. We don't believe in cleanliness. We believe in pizza grease fingerprints going to space. And so we have a method to our madness, which is we do everything in not a clean room because we're students and clean rooms are a pain in the ass and they slow everything down. So everything is done here in our little flat, in our little corral. So we have a soldering bench over there, and a toolkit and a testing bench over here. And this is really where we do everything for our satellite. And when we're all done, we dunk everything in isopropyl alcohol, rub it all down, and put it in that. And that is our clean box. And it's literally just an $800 laminar flow hood with a nice anti-static base to it. And when we're in flight mode, we will turn that thing on and it will clean off every single thing, move it into the clean box, and assemble for flight. And I think that that's the best possible way of doing it. I can't think of anything better because clean rooms are a pain in the ass. They slow you down, going in, going out, all that kind of stuff. This way, we can do rapid turns, we can build stuff rapidly, we can prototype stuff rapidly, and only when we need to go to space can we slow down, clean everything off, and assemble it carefully. Hope that answers that question.
Yeah. If I can add sort of an addendum to that,
Yeah.
yeah, even the SMAD, like the latest issue in like 2011, in their small sat section, they say pretty clearly that it's like, yeah, for small sats, like clean rooms are great for press photos, but a total waste of time for actually like
No,
doing
that's
the
not fair.
assembly. And I think a lot of the cleanliness standards, I mean, obviously, if you're doing like a space telescope or something, like sure, right? You want James Webb to be pretty clean. But it's like, I think a lot of the cleanliness standards either come from like really intense optical stuff
Yeah.
or you're going to Mars, right? And you have planetary protection and you don't want to bring along a bunch of microbes. But for pretty much all the other everyday stuff, like I've my, my buddies who work at SpaceX, they're like, yeah, like they basically build Starlinks like in an auto shop, right? Like doors open, like open to the air, and they just shove them in. So like
That's great.
it's really not that big of a deal.
Yeah.
And yeah, like you think about cleanliness is like you can always just clean it later,
Yeah,
you know? And
right.
so if you want a cleanliness standard, just clean it at the end.
Yep.
And so I have a question as well, actually, Andrew. Yeah. Which is I noticed you guys don't appear to conformal coat any of your boards. Is there a particular reason, or do you just not want to bother?
We're anti-conformal coating.
Okay, you actively hate conformal coating.
Yeah. For two reasons. The first is once you conformally coat, you can't go back and can't fix a board. I mean, you can kind of, but it's a super big pain in the ass. Also, I don't
Yeah.
think conformal coating wins you anything. Now, I can be convinced someone could show me data that says conformal coating super helps you with X, right? X might be thermal, right? You might get a slightly better thermal resistance with a conformal coating, right? That I believe, but not a lot more. And if you just do your ground planes right, then you should be able to deal with it that way. It's protected from dust and moisture, which doesn't matter in space. Maybe it does something with charging, maybe. But I don't see a really good reason to do it. Besides paranoia. So someone
Yeah.
should get me real information on why we should conformally coat boards, and then we would conformally coat the boards literally the day before we go to flight, so that we can
Yeah.
continuously run them and debug them and do all that kind of stuff, and then go from there.
Yeah. It is an interesting one for BroncoSat, which didn't end up working anyways. Like we did conformal coat everything and it was a big pain in the ass. Because yeah, exactly what you say, right? Where it's like, oh yeah, if you want to rework, you got to melt it off with acetone or something, right? Or just get a new board. Also, like doing conformal coat at home, like all the chemicals are super toxic. So it's like I hope you like Prop 65 warnings here in California. Maybe getting cancer or birth defects.
And here's
yeah,
the thing.
I. Mm-hmm.
I think that it just doesn't buy you enough. Like, if you really, really cared about thermal stuff, then you should buy a thermal epoxy that doesn't outgas. And even like a 3M 2216 is better than that. You can just flood it over your chip. In fact, now that I say that, why the hell did we not do that?
We have joked. We have joked about flying the block of glue.
Totally. Oh, well, okay,
Yeah.
now I feel stupid.
But
There was two chips that we are afraid of getting too hot because we saw them get too hot in vacuum tests. And now I don't know why we didn't flood fill them with 2216 or something equivalent that's good, got good thermal conductivity.
yeah. I think outside of those reasons, like it is just like, oh yeah, I guess you would stop an arc, if like an unfortunate whatever happened between two pins. But it's like, how often does that really happen? It's hard to say.
And if you don't clean it well enough, then you've got lots of grease and other stuff on the outside to bleed off the charges. So you're fine. Just don't be too clean.
Yeah. Actually, just a related question, Andrew. Have you, in your entire career, ever seen like a true ESD shock failure? Like someone zaps something and it's like, oh wow, that's really, really dead now.
No.
I personally haven't, so I feel like it's fake news, but I'm sure it has happened.
So the ESD is the boogeyman, right? Someone asked if I can share the slides. Yeah, I'll share the slides. I'll give them to you, Michael, and you can give share
Thanks.
them. I think ESD is a boogeyman because you can't see it, you can't feel it, and something dies, and you're like, oh, it was ESD, right? Now, I do think ESD is a problem, and I do think that if you're not careful, you can absolutely blow stuff up with ESD. However, we're up here in Oregon. We don't give a shit because we got water everywhere, including in the air, and we've got a relative humidity meter, and it's never below like 25% or whatever you're supposed to have, right? The other thing is when we handle our boards, we always handle them like this. And so the first thing you do when someone grabs it is you ground yourself on the ground plane on the outside. And I think that that's probably that kind of idea of how do you handle the boards and making sure your mats, your stations are ESD sensitive. I think that's enough. I don't think you have to go too nuts, but going a little nuts is a good idea. That's right. And by the way, I've done hundreds of thousands of manufacturing things. And when we were developing all of those things in our labs, we never did a lot of ESD. When you go into production, you do ESD because you're paranoid. But I never saw a single failure with hundreds to thousands of units that we built locally with that were ESD, that were mysterious ESD, right? Well, I've blathered long enough, I think.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I guess if no one has any follow-up questions, we can probably wrap it here. Does anyone have any last minute things they want to toss in? All right. Thank you so much for your time, Andrew. Yeah,
Please,
just thanks.
please. I'll
That's
just say
all I
one
have
last
to say.
thing, which is please help. We need help. We want help. There's tons to do. We're super collaborative. Everything's published. We're willing to help you as much as we can, which is not a lot. So this is like a deep dive for everybody who gets involved. But this is a pretty cool project, and we're hopeful to do more and more and more CPP in Bronco space and have you guys on board with OreSat and grab our stuff and run with it and make it better and use it for your own stuff. And then we'll get the pull request saying, hey, we fix this and it works better. That's what we want, because all of our designs suck and they're all terrible. So help us make better stuff. So thank you. All right, guys.
All right. Thank you so much, Andrew. And yeah, we hope.